Okay, so there are a few remaining topics with regard to memories that I'll be covering today. Couple of minor announcements. One is next week I will not be here. I'm traveling next week, so I'll not be taking any classes. What I'm planning to do before that is, first of all, make sure that we'll be covering a little bit of the next topic, which is Verilog and how you use it for simulation. And there will be one assignment based on Verilog that will be that you can work on during that time. Apart from that, of course, I would suggest that you please use that time in order to work on the main course project itself. Okay, do not put it off any further. This is pretty much close to the end of the semester. So use that time in order to work on the project. The TAs also can arrange times when they will be available to help you with any doubts that you have. But please use the next week in order to finish that off. I do not anticipate taking extra classes because we are doing okay as far as overall time is concerned. But please make sure that the projects etc. are done properly. Okay? If there are any other things that you would want covered during the time, please let me know and I'll see if I can work with the TAs to sort of have some additional coverage during the next week. Okay, so coming back to the memory design, we already saw the structure of a 6 transistor SRAM cell, right? And what we saw was one of the components that is there is that we essentially end up with bitline and bitline bar, two different values. The bitline and bitline bar have very high values of capacitance. So it will take a long time for those bitline and bitline bar to reach the value of 0 and 1 when you are trying to read, because they are trying to discharge through relatively small transistors. Okay? So what we do is we use something called a sense amplifier, which does not wait until the bitline and bitline bar have changed their values completely. Instead, what it does is, even if it sees a small change in the value, it will respond to it and try to convert that into a full logic 0 or 1. Okay? One example of what a structure like this can look like is something as follows. Now this is one example. It is only one example. There are many different possible designs that can be done. It is one possible way by which you can create a sense amplifier which will take in the two inputs BL and BL bar and convert them into proper logic output. Right?
Also need the cross-coupled feedback.
Now if you look at the central portion over here, this effectively looks something like two back-to-back inverters, except for one crucial difference, this footer transistor, right? So effectively, in other words, because see, if you had this back-to-back inverters permanently connected to the bit line, then effectively those two back-to-back inverters are going to try and pull the bit line and bit line bar to opposite values. Okay. Instead, what we do is we put another footer transistor over there, the NMOS, such that only when clock is equal to 1, those two inverters are going to pull towards logic values. Okay. When clock is equal to 0, the entire those two back-to-back inverters are disabled because there is no pull-down path for them. Okay. So in this way, effectively what happens is that the moment that bitline and bitline bar see some difference, right, you are applying that difference to the input of a pair of cross-coupled inverters, and those inverters will then start to amplify that difference, right? The one which is seeing a logic 1 at its input will remain as logic 1, but the one that's seeing something lower than that at the input will start switching. It has something lower at the input, and it also has the other inverter trying to drive a 0 onto its input. Both of them together will be sufficient to make it completely flip state. Okay? So in this way, what will happen is that very soon the value that is present at the output of this, at these points, this will be the proper sensed output. Okay? Now one thing that you need to keep in mind over here is bitline and bitline bar, you don't even need to wait for them to go all the way down to 0 or 1. Right? As soon as the sense and sense bar have reached the proper logic value, you can declare, okay, I mean the clock time period that you are using over here only needs to be sufficient waiting for sense and sense bar to reach some proper value. And the next stage will be able to read it as a proper logic level, either 0 or 1. Okay. Now, one thing of course is this requires the presence of a clock. Whereas previous, as we were looking at the design of the SRAM cell, you don't require a clock. Okay. All the operation over there is just based on the bit lines and word lines. The clock is not mandatory in such a situation. Right. So if that is the case, then basically what we can say is, I mean, if you have a clock system, then you can use this kind of sense amplifier. Otherwise, some other variant is required. I'm not going to go into the details. Okay? There are a number of different books itself that work with different aspects of sense amplifier design. So you can look those up for reference if you like. Okay? Now, as far as bitline and bitline bar are concerned, one thing that is usually done in practice is you need to pre-charge them. Okay. But you also want to make sure that both of them have the same value, because if there is some mismatch between these transistors and they don't come to exactly the same value, there is a possibility that you can end up with some slight mismatch between the voltages at bitline and bitline bar, which will be picked up by the sense amplifier, even though it's not a proper logic value. Okay. So because of that, usually what is done in practice is to put a transistor between these two, right, and enable this one also. What does this transistor do? It essentially ensures that BL and BL bar are at the same high voltage, right? You can essentially just ground this, make sure that the PMOS is on, and PMOS is good at transferring one, so it will make sure that both the sides end up at the same voltage. Okay. This is just an additional thing that is used in order to make sure that both the signals pre-charge to the same value. Why do you need to take care of all of these considerations? Because sense amplifiers, by their very nature, are very sensitive to small differences. So you want them to be sensitive to small differences in voltage, right? So if you don't put in such precautions to make sure that they charge up to the same voltage, and if there is a clock or some other signal to ensure when they start actually evaluating, there is a possibility that they will even pick up some noise signal from anywhere. Some other voltage sitting in some other part of the circuit can result in some change in the values that you see over here. Okay? So to avoid all that is what we do this kind of circuit. Right? Okay. One other trick that is sometimes used is to say that, do I really need to charge the voltages, BL and BL bar? Instead of pre-charging to VDD, we pre-charge it to something else. Let's say VDD by 2. Right? Why is this a good thing? Because now it sort of makes it easier. Otherwise, what happens is always the one is favored and zero is the one that has to struggle to pull the voltage down. Okay. Whereas so here what you are saying is, I will put it at a voltage which is halfway between 0 and 1, which means that whether the voltage is going to switch to 0 or to 1, that can happen quite easily, right? We make the switching for the sense amplifier symmetric between 0 and 1, right? All of these are small tricks that are used in SRAM design in order to gain some additional speed usage. Okay? So in all of these cases, the thing is, you know that there is a huge capacitance associated with the bit line. You want to make some modifications or optimizations to the line in order to improve its performance. What are all the things that you can do in order to, first of all, make it less sensitive to random noise and quicker at responding to an actual change that it should? Those are the two considerations that you have while designing sense amplifier. Okay. Alright. Now, the next thing that you might come across in the discussion of SRAM, a normal SRAM has this kind of a structure, right? There is an address bus, a data in, and a data out. Usually data in and data out are the same thing, they are on the bit line. I am drawing them explicitly as two separate things just to show that you can read and write, you could if you wanted to read and write from separate lines. Okay? Because the reading and writing operations in some sense are different. Now the first thing that we can imagine is, if I draw it this way, is it possible to both read and write at the same time? Okay? In other words, can I read from an SRAM cell while at the same time writing into it? Okay? The first question that comes up over there then is, which value should you read? Should you read the value which was previously there in the SRAM cell, or should you read the value which you are writing? Okay? That of course is a decision which actually depends on the SRAM cell designer itself. You have to sort of make a decision and put it in the data sheet saying that, look, if you do a read during the write, you will get the value that was being written, or you will get the previous value that was there and the value that you are writing now will come only in the next read. Either one of those decisions can be made. Right? In order to do something like that, you might or might not need the presence of a clock, but that's again something that is additionally required. Now, the important point over here is, supposing I was to modify this and make it such that I have two addresses, not one. Okay? I consider only the reading part for now. And I want to read out two values at the same time. Okay? Question is this possible and how would you make such a modification to the system? So that I can read two different values at the same time. If I wanted to do that using the same SRAM structure, how would I do something like this? Now, in terms of terminology, this is usually called a two-port read SRAM. Okay? I can also imagine something like this, where I have one write port two read port. And this would be called a 3-port SRAM. Right? In other words, the number of ports that we are talking about over here essentially refers to the number of data buses that are connected. Okay? So in that sense, this is also in some sense a 2-port, one read, one write. In this case, the difference is the two ports are both connected by the same address. Otherwise, I could have different addresses going to each of the read and write ports as well. it's a question of how many data can I get out of the SRAM at one shot, or how many data can I put into it. Okay. Now there are lots of applications for these kind of two port and other related two port, three port, and so on SRAM. Okay. RAM in general, not SRAM. RAM in general. Okay. The idea is that if I can take out multiple values at the same time, one possible place where this could be useful is, let's say that I'm trying to construct a processor core and I want to implement some kind of an instruction such as R1 is equal to R2 plus R3. Okay, three registers are there, R1, R2 and R3. Okay, now if I had this kind of a structure, right, one write and two read port, then I can use it for the register file. How? I give two addresses for reading, R2 and R3. Those two values come out at DOUT1 and DOUT2. Okay. I take those values, feed them into the ALU, whatever arithmetic, maybe I add them together, take the output and feed it into the input and give the address of R1 to that. Okay. So I can read out two values, write in one value, all at the same time. Okay. Question is, how can I achieve something of the sort? How can this be constructed? Right. If you think about it, it's not very difficult. What does the basic SRAM cell look like? I'll just draw one side of it alone. This is for reading. Okay. It is also for writing, because after all we use the same kind of structure for writing. But supposing I modify this, and say I'll isolate the reading from the writing, happens is that problem that I had, that the bit line will try to pull up the internal transistor of the SRAM cell, that is no longer possible because of isolated. Okay. Now because of that, because of the fact that I isolated the internal transistor from the bit line, it means I can attach additional bit lines to it if I wanted to. DL1 and DL2 are two different bit lines. They are controlled by two different word lines, WL1 and WL2. When I activate WL1, the value which is inside the SRAM cell will come out onto BL1. When I activate WL2, the value which is on the SRAM cell will come out onto BL2. Okay? Which means I have effectively got the ability to read two independent data at the same time. Of course, I will still need the sense amplifiers and all separately for BL1 and BL2. Right? Both of them need to be processed. But depending on which WL I activate, WL1, WL2, I can have one WL1 accessing one particular row of the SRAM, WL2 accessing some other row of the SRAM. The data from the first row will come out on BL1, the data from the second row will come out on BL2. Okay? This means I can read two values at the same time. Okay. So this is an example of two port read. Okay. A similar kind of structure can be used for writing. I'm not going to draw that out in detail. It's described in the textbook. in Vesey and Harris for sure, right? Where what you can do is essentially a similar kind of thing, right? For writing, what you do, you normally put the values on the bit line, then activate the word line so that the data is going to get written in. Now what you need to do is have multiple such access transistors which allow different bit lines to be able to write into the same memory cell. Make sure that as far as the given cell is concerned, only one particular bit line set gets activated at a time, so that you only try writing one value at a time. Okay? Obviously, if I have two write ports and I try writing opposite values into both of them, into the same address, then I definitely have a problem anyway. But as long as I can ensure that the addresses to which I am writing are different, I can happily put in two different values and try writing them into two different addresses at the same time by means of a similar mechanism. Okay? So multi-ported SRAMs can also be created relatively easily by using the same structure and just adding a little bit extra logic to it. Okay. Alright. Now, overall what we saw was, as far as the SRAM cell is concerned, for correct operation, we needed to have the sizes looking something like this. The pull-down NMOS transistors needed to be strong. Right? Why is that? Because we want to make sure that the voltage at this Q point over here does not rise too high when I try to read. So they need to be strong or wide compared to the access transistors which are of medium size. And the access transistors themselves have to be stronger than the PMOS pull-up. Otherwise, that pull-up ratio will not be satisfied and you won't be able to write data into the SRAM cell. Okay? So roughly speaking, this is the structure that we have. Right? The NMOS pull-down transistors need to be strong. The access transistors are somewhat medium size. And the pull-up transistors, the PMOS, have to be weak. Okay. So one of the things that was then attempted was, let's go for this structure. What have I done here? I've just got rid of the PMOS. Okay? Question is, does it still behave like a memory cell? What do you think? What is this going to do? Is it going to behave like a memory cell or not? What is it that we are looking for over here? We want to see whether the 0 and 1 values will remain over there, right? How can they remain? How can this particular cell retain value? On what basis is it going to retain the value that you put in there? Where is the data going to be stored? There is no feedback loop, right? Or rather, there is a feedback loop, but what is the problem with the feedback loop? There is no pull-up PMOS transistor. So even though the voltage at some particular point is high, there is nothing to pull it up and keep it high. Which means that high is only being stored on some capacitance over here and on some capacitance over here. Right? As long as there is voltage on those capacitances, charge across those capacitances, the voltage over there will be high. One of them will be high, the other one will be low. Okay? And this will also behave similar to a transistor, to a SRAM cell. Except that it does not have static pull-up. Therefore, it is a dynamic cell. Okay? Because, for example, when this value is, if this is 1 and this is 0, this point is floating. This point is floating. Okay? There is nothing which is actively pulling it up to 1. Okay? So this is a dynamic cell. And therefore, the structure is called a dynamic RAM. Okay? What's the advantage over SRAM? Fewer transistors, it's smaller. Right? So this is one thing which we can see. By taking out two of those transistors, you have made the cell smaller. The disadvantage, of course, is it is now dynamic. There is a floating node somewhere in the system. And that floating node means that possibly the value over there can get messed up with time. Okay? So, the rest of the access, etc. is the same as for a 6 transistor SRAM cell. No other differences. Right? But what needs to be done for this is, supposing I store 1 and 0 like this in this for a 4 transistor DRAM cell. After a while, what I'll find is, after some time, meaning let's say after several milliseconds or so, I'll find that the charge which was there at that 1 is less than what it was when it started up. Okay? How can I fix that? If I ask you to make sure that the charge over there is once again gets pulled back up to VDD, how would you do that? No, if you put a resistor or a PMOS transistor, that's once again pulling it up, making it static. I don't want to do that. Write the same value back. Okay? So what do? You basically do one operation whereby you take the bit line, okay, precharge them as usual, as though you are going to read. Activate the word line. Let the bit lines go to 0 and 1. In fact, let them go all the way to 0 and 1 properly. Right? Let the sense amplifier activate the bit lines and pull the bit lines all the way to 0 and 1. Okay? And once you have done that, activating it to 0 and 1, you once again activate that word line. What will happen? The same 0 and 1, that combination, will get rewritten back into the SRAM, into the DRAM cell. Okay? This operation, where you read, and then rewrite the same data, is called a refresh. Okay? And this is something which is very important for all DRAM cells, not just the one that we are looking at now, even for the next couple of things that we will look at. All DRAM cells have this problem that there is a dynamic node, a floating node somewhere. Left to itself, that node will lose its charge. Okay. So what do? You read the value on that node and then you write it back. So so that you can guarantee that the value on that node is pulled back up to GDD if necessary. Okay. So this structure is called refresh and is compulsory. It has to be done for DRAM cell. How often does it have to be done? Not every few nanoseconds. Maybe not even every few microseconds. It may be sufficient to do it once in a few milliseconds or so. Right? Because within that kind of time frame, within several microseconds to millisecond range, it is possible that enough charge would otherwise leak away that the value is no longer stored at that point. Right? But once in 1 millisecond or once in 10 milliseconds or so, if you rewrite the value, that is good enough for the DRAM cell to retain its charge until the next time that you refresh it. Okay? And in fact, this kind of operation where you refresh the contents of DRAM has to be done as far as all DRAMs are concerned. Okay? Which is one of the things that makes DRAMs a bit more complicated to use than SRAM. As far as SRAM is concerned, you connect it, you give it address, it will give you data. You give it address and data, it will write into the memory. For DRAM, you can still read and write the data, but you also need to make sure that at regular intervals, you are refreshing the entire DRAM. Okay? This has to be done one word at a time. One entire row can be refreshed at one shot by activating it. Right? One word line you use in order to basically do a read and a write from the entire row. But it has to be done, which means that while you are refreshing, you cannot read or write from somewhere else in the RAM. Okay? So your controller has to be smart enough to know that I am trying to refresh right now. If somebody is trying to read from the RAM, then wait. You put that read operation on hold. Wait until the refresh has completed, then read and give the data. Okay? As a result of that, the operation of DRAM has this additional problem that you cannot always guarantee a sort of single cycle or fixed amount of latency for the reading. It's possible that you are in the middle of a refresh cycle. You have to wait until that is over before you can do the reading. So anyway, right now the advantage seems to be relatively small. You have cut down from 6 transistors to 4 transistors. But you have got all the headaches of having to refresh and so on. Okay? If that was all there was to it, then people would not have bothered. They would have said, okay, forget DRAM, we'll just stick with SRAM itself. But the thing is, you can do better than this. Another example of a DRAM structure is a single transistor for storing the data. The data is stored on its gate capacitance. For reading, I have an access transistor which is connected to the read word line, and this is the read bit line. So if I activate the read word line, the data on the read bit line will become 0 or 1 depending on whether the value that was stored on this capacitance was a 1 or a 0. If the voltage on the capacitance is high, then the read bit line will go low. So it will read sort of the opposite of what you are storing inside the DRAM cell. Okay? This is non-destructive. Unlike the case of SRAM, because of this access transistor, the way it is connected, it's not connected to the gate of the transistor. It's connected to the drain. So there is no way that it can destroy the contents of what is written inside the cell. Okay? So reading is good. It can be done this way. For writing, I use another write word line and write bit line. I put a 0 or a 1 on the write bit line and activate the write word line. And accordingly, this capacitor over here will either charge or discharge. If it discharges, it will discharge all the way down to 0. If it charges, it will charge maybe only up to VDD minus VT, but that's still good enough for me. It stores the content on that capacitor over there. Okay? This is called a 3-transistor DRAM cell. Now this is looking better. It's half the size of the 6 transistor SRAM cell. Okay. Now maybe people might actually be interested in saying, okay, you know, this is good enough that I will consider all the overheads of refresh and so on and implement a DRAM instead of SRAM because I want higher density. I want to be able to store more data. Right? But you can go one step better than this. What happens for most commercial DRAM is that you use a different structure which looks something like this. Right? This tree, this capacitor, is not just the gate capacitor or the drain capacitor of that NMOS transistor. This is something called a trench capacitor. Right? And requires special processing in order to create it. Right? The way that it works is you need to have a special processing step which will create some kind of a bead structure inside the silicon. And that area is essentially made into a capacitor by having effectively two parallel plates, two plates that are separated by an insulating gap. Okay. Why the trench structure? Because with minimum area, you are able to get higher surface area, which means higher capacitor. Okay. Now this trench capacitor has a much higher capacitance than the regular gate capacitance or drain capacitance of a NMOS or PMOS transistor. Right? It is used as a storage device. And there is just one access transistor that is present over there. Okay? How does reading work? Precharge bitline. The bitline has a certain capacitance, CB, activates WL. Okay. What happens when you activate WL? What will happen to the voltage on DL? Supposing the value stored in the capacitance was a zero. That's the important point, right? Well, supposing the value stored in the capacitance was 1, then it doesn't really matter. The bitline is just going to remain precharged. But supposing the value stored in the capacitance was 0, what will happen to the voltage on DL? Charge sharing will happen. Right? So the delta V will be given by C by C plus CV of VV. Right? If C is very small with respect to CB, then this delta V is going to be extremely small, you can't do anything with it. But if C is sufficiently large, if you can make it at least like appreciable, maybe to the point where it's around, you know, so if the delta V is around 0.1 or 0.2 volts, that is good enough. A sense amplifier can take over from there. Okay? So this delta V will then be picked up by the sense amplifier, which will give you a logic 0 or 1, whatever was stored inside the cell. As far as writing is concerned, put data onto DL, activate WL. That's it. Supposing I want to discharge the contents of the cell, make DL equal to 0 and activate WL. Supposing I want to write a 1 into the cell, put DL equal to 1, activate WL. Right? It won't go all the way up to VDD, it will go up to VDD minus VDD, but that's okay, it's still good enough. Right? Now this structure, the 1TS DRAM cell, is the most popular present style of DRAM implementation. Right? The storage cell. Single transistor for access and a trench capacitor for storage. Okay? It is much smaller than an equivalent SRAM cell, which means that the density that you can get, the amount of storage per unit area, is much higher than the case of the SRAM cell. Okay. What's the drawback? It is dynamic, therefore you have to refresh. Okay, this also has the same refresh problem. If you just leave it like that, then even though it's a French capacitor, it will lose the charge. There will be some leakage current. Okay. And the moment you have refresh, it means you need a complicated memory controller and the latency of accessing a given value is no longer fixed. Okay. But still it is used in practice. Okay. Alright. So DRAM is the most popular kind of memory which is used for mass storage, for large amounts of data to be stored. So typically in a computer system, what you will find is that when somebody asks you what is the RAM of the system, how much RAM is there, and you say it's 1 GB or 2 GB or 8 GB, whatever number it is, that refers to the DRAM. Right? Because the DRAM is what you can get in such huge density that you can create gigabytes of RAM out of it. In terms of how it is implemented, usually what happens is DRAM modules are created. You take multiple such DRAM chips, combine them together into one module, and that module needs to get inserted onto the motherboard. And you can sort of replace those chips, those entire modules, and either upgrade or improve the quality of the memory that you have. SRAM is almost never used that way because it's not possible to get the same kind of density. Okay? But where it is used instead is, supposing you are trying to have register or cache memory inside a processor. Right? Those kind of memory blocks require a fixed latency. I give some address, I should know exactly how much time it will take me before I get the data back. Okay? They are not very large. The entire idea of a cache is that it is relatively small compared to the main memory, but stores only the important data. Okay? So it satisfies all the requirements which you have, which means that you can use an SRAM, even though it is not as dense as a DRAM, in order to store the data over there. Okay? Alright. Now, the next thing is what is called a content addressable memory. Or a CAM. Right? In terms of the overall code structure, it looks something like this. As usual, there is a read, write, address, and data. Okay. So far it looks exactly like a regular SRAM structure, SRAM or DRAM structure. Right? But now what is done is, in addition to the data, we say that I can also put a key on this. And in this case, there is one additional output, which is a set of signals called MAC. Okay. How does the MAC operation work? Put the key onto the data bus. And actually that's it, so you don't really need to do anything else depending on what it is. If the key is present in some word or row, that MAC line will go high. Of course, it will be pre-charged high. The way that it works is something like this. The structure will be, we have the regular SRAM cell structure. So what does this do? Essentially what we have is we have Q over here, Q bar over here, right? Supposing Q is not equal to B, right? So I precharge the max line, I precharge it high. Okay, and then I activate, or rather not activate, but I put the values onto the BL and BL bar. Okay, when Q is not equal to B, let's say that Q was 1 and B bar is also 1, what will happen is I have a path which goes like this. Q is not equal to B, right? So Q is equal to B bar is equal to 1, it will discharge through both of those transistors, math will get pulled low. But if that does not happen, if Q is equal to B, then there is no pull down path and math will remain high. Okay. So effectively what we are doing is, we are saying that I put data onto the bit line. If the data matches with what is stored inside the cell, then the match line will remain high. If it does not match, then the match line will get pulled low. Okay? And in this way, by taking out all of these match lines, I can get a easy picture of which of the rows contain the value that I was trying to put over there. Then I can do some kind of priority encoding and say, okay, I'll take the first row or some other row or some random row. Right? If at least one of the rows is correct, I'll pick any one of them, something, some decision of that sort I can make. Right? But I have managed to detect a match. And so this becomes content addressable. By knowing the content of the cell, I can tell you whether or not the data is present in the cell. And by looking at the word line, I can tell you in which cell it is present. Okay? This becomes useful in a number of places. For example, when you are making routers for networking, you need to be able to store a number of different routing tables, which basically says, okay, if I have this IP address, the data should go on this port or should be sent in this direction. And those routing tables can become fairly large, thousands of entries. And you want it to be extremely fast. So what do? You create a content addressable memory which contains the address. Then when some new packet comes, you put the address onto that and say, okay, do you know where to send this? There will be some match in the slide which says, okay, this is the content, this is where you need to send it. Okay? Now, the other thing you can do is, by NORing all the match outputs together, you can also tell if there was a miss, that is none of the rows contains the data. So if none of the rows contain the data, then the NOR of the match line from all of them will be equal to 1. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. Continue tomorrow.